The Marche Militaire, No. 1, Deutsch 733. Schubert is renowned, among other things, for his wistful melancholy and for his deep sorrow, but almost as characteristic is his capacity for anger, even violence, in both his music and his life. We saw that one extraordinary eruption in the tavern after the opera, back then an isolated outburst. It now begins to seem part of a pattern. Schubert was raised as a devout Roman Catholic in a country where the alliance of church and state traditionally conspired to stifle dissent and so-called free thought. But in Schubert's case, the treatment was riven with flaws. His attitude to religion in general, and to Christianity in particular, was ambivalent, to say the least. It's interesting that in all his settings of the Mass, from the age of 17 onwards, he pointedly left out the words et unam sanctam catholicam et apostolicam ecclesiam, in one Catholic and apostolic church. And the Hungarian clergy really seemed to have brought out the beast in him.
You can't imagine what a gang the priesthood is here. As bigoted as mucky old cattle, stupid as arch donkeys, and as boorish as bisons. You can hear sermons here, the like of which even our venerated padre can't begin to match. They blather on something lovely from the pulpit about blackguards and riffraff and so on. Oh, and they put a death's head on the pulpit and say, "See here, you pock-pitted mugs, this is what you'll look like one day." Or else, "There, fellow takes a slot into the pub, they dance all night, then they go to bed tight, and when they get up, there are three of them."
In November, Schubert returned with the Esterházys to Vienna, where he moved in with Johann Mayrhofer, 10 years his senior and one of the most profound influences on his development as a songwriter. Schubert set many of his verses to music, and Mayrhofer further instilled in him the poetic values of the Romantic movement and deepened his already exceptional sensitivity to language. They made an odd pair. Schubert, the cheerful, diminutive innocent with his head in the clouds, this anyway is how he was commonly perceived, and Mayrhofer, the sophisticated, world-weary misanthrope, whose deeply melancholic temperament led to his suicide 8 years after Schubert's death. The single room they shared, in well-planned alternation, wasn't in itself anything to write home about, but what came out of it was beyond price. As Mayrhofer reflected,
"The room itself had felt the hand of time. The ceiling somewhat sunk, the daylight reduced by a large building opposite, a clapped-out piano, a single narrow bookshelf. Such was the room which, together with the hours spent in it, will never be effaced from my memory."
In the course of the next 2 years, as Anselm Hüttenbrenner observed, Schubert came as close as he ever did to establishing a regular routine.
"Every morning at 6 o'clock sharp he sat down at his desk and composed right through till 1 or 2 in the afternoon, in the course of which many a pipe was smoked. After that he never composed during the afternoon, but rather went to a coffee house, where he would sit over a small cup of black coffee for 1 hour or 2, reading the newspapers and smoking. In the evenings he socialised with friends and very occasionally would go to the theatre."
Their lives were organized in such a way that, during the day at least, the two men were rarely in the room at the same time. But there were inevitable overlaps, and Mayrhofer admitted, with characteristic delicacy, that the mix of temperaments wasn't always an easy one.
"Our idiosyncrasies could not but show themselves. We were both richly endowed in this respect, and the consequences could not fail to appear. Schubert's happy, outgoing nature and my introspective one were thus thrown into high relief."
It's interesting that even Mayrhofer, who shared a room with him for 2 years, characterizes Schubert's as a happy, outgoing nature. Throughout the 19th century and most of the 20th, this was the standard popular image, despite the fact that an enormous amount of Schubert's music suggests otherwise. To a certain extent, this was consciously fostered by many of his friends after his death, and it goes along with the complimentary myth that his personality was simple. Spaun declared it as a fact.
"Schubert's mode of life was as simple as he was himself."
Well, let's look at the evidence. First, the music, and we won't cook the books by turning to his later music. Only a little time after that popular populist Marche Militaire came what's generally regarded as Schubert's first instrumental masterpiece, the lone quartet movement in C minor, known for some reason by the German name Quartettsatz, which simply means quartet movement. But what a movement!